So we have a new album called Songs from the Hard Shoulder, and it's been 20 years since we formed the band The Tangent, and now we've got to our 12th album, and we decided to kind of relax a lot of the constraints on ourselves, work less in the area of trying to be successful, and we just let the guards down and did exactly what we wanted to do this time. I think that's the important thing, and of course that's resulted in a rather odd selection of tracks, in the fact that there's three long epic tracks, one short song which is nothing like the rest of the album at all, and then as a bonus we've done a cover version. This does not make what most people would consider to be a kind of commercially viable and balanced album, personally, obviously, you know, it's don't take it from me, but I think it kind of works, I think one of the first things to say is that, like, the songs are completely different from each other in so many ways. The three epics could be by three different bands, if you were going to look at it that way. The first one being very very song oriented. That is a very typical Tangent piece, to be sure. That first song is called The Changes.
See those places from the photos in the box. Will I ever walk those streets again? And will I ever see the faces of the people that I love and put my arms around them without fear? Without guilt.
This was a song I wrote during the first of the lockdowns. That strange world we all lived in. And I think that kind of set the theme for what I was trying to say, and became part of how we got the album's title, Songs from the Hard Shoulder. For people who don't know what a hard shoulder is, because it's not the same phrase everywhere in the world, but the hard shoulder is in effect the breakdown lane on a motorway, freeway, autoroute, autobahn, whatever. You watch the rest of the world go past and wonder what's going to happen to you. In the case of this song, The Changes, it was a kind of like the whole world was on the breakdown lane, wasn't it? And there wasn't any traffic going past in there. And that was a very kind of strange situation to be in. And a lot of us had a lot of kind of thoughts about what the future held and where we were all going, and whether we'd see certain people again, and all those kind of typical human worries, really. And so I wrote a song to cover my view of it, and, you know, hoping that out of that sort of very strange time we could learn something and move ahead with it. Now, of course, writing songs about a certain period in time, particularly in the present, can immediately be put completely out of date. And of course, you know, since that time, you're about to receive or hear this song for the first time, maybe. And of course, since that point, we've had three other lockdowns, a major war developing in the world, and all sorts of other problems, which just puts this one sort of into, you know, the past. But this is what the Tangent do. We write about current events, and current events are never current by the time we release the record. So it's just a little snapshot of time that we've taken. Anyway, the thing is that although the song concentrates on me missing people, me missing the band, and of course everybody missing everybody else, it is an optimistic song. It's a very optimistic song, with the way the thing builds up at the end to a totally uplifting guitar solo, the likes of which you haven't heard for a long time, actually. The overall feeling is, let's reach out, let's try to do better. The second song is not a song, it's an instrumental. It's another 17 minute long epic piece. It's very much in the kind of style that we started working in with a song called Dr. Livingston, I presume, a few albums back. We've done a few instrumentals now, and we really enjoy doing them. Particularly those people who don't enjoy my singing too much, it's kind of a nice thing for them to happen. But this one is a very organized thing. It's been influenced by all kinds of input, obviously there's a lot of the kind of Canterbury stuff and palette that I often use, that's present. And there's a lot of one of my heroes, Bo Hansson, the Swedish keyboards player, who is one of my favorite musicians of all time. And there's a lot of his stuff in there. Particularly, one of the things I used to really like about Bo Hansson is that he used to sort of like use quite a lot of Latin rhythms and make them sound completely non-Latin for some reason. So he could do sambas, but you wouldn't actually sort of like listen to it and think samba. You wouldn't immediately want to start doing some kind of dance around the room or anything. And he even used kind of Latin rhythms to express, a lot of his inspiration from Lord of the Rings. His personal take on the flight to the ford, as Frodo and Sam are being chased on Shadowmax towards Rivendell, pursued by black riders, Bo Hansson expressed this as the form of a samba, and it really, really works. It's a samba with kind of cranky old organs, mellotrons, distorted electric guitars, and the rhythm works with a different set of instrumentation to produce something completely different. And I was inspired by that and decided to try and use that kind of effect a little. It's a very, very structured piece, and there's an awful lot in it. It is quite a thing. So that's second bit. It's called GPS Vultures, which is a sort of pun on a song that The Tangent released in 2006 called GPS Culture, and it's built up rather like a set of classical variations on a theme, in that although it isn't anything to do with GPS cultures as a sort of like thematic piece, it's based on a similar set of chord structures and shapes that I used back then, and using that starting point, go somewhere else with the same group of building blocks, shall we say. The third epic is called The Lady Tied to the Lamppost, and this is another song about the breakdown lane of life, as I mentioned before, in this case featuring a person I met, a lady who was quite honestly and literally tied to a lamppost.
She's got no one in the world. Nothing in the world.
Tied to a lamppost, and she'd done this to herself because she was homeless, and in tying herself to the lamppost, she prevented herself from falling over and hurting her head during the night. And I met her on a bitterly, bitterly cold night in December, a few years back, when I was on my way home from a Christmas party, and I had very little to give her, just a cigarette, and I decided that I would write this song about her whilst I was on my way home, and the actual decision to write the song is actually a focal point of it, because like I had to ask myself, what the hell did writing this song ever do for her? Well, you know, she is totally unaware of the fact I ever wrote this song, probably, and of course it didn't make her any more comfortable or relieve the pain and suffering she was going through at that point. I had a very, very, very brief time when I was actually without a place to stay myself. I won't say I was homeless, because but I was on the streets for a number of nights in Paris, and it's a very scaring moment as the lights starts to drop out of the sky, and you realise that everybody's on their way home, and soon there will be you and whoever else is left in the centre of town. You know, it's not something I particularly envisage the idea of repeating, and I sincerely hope it never happens to me or anybody else, for that matter. It's a horrible feeling, and I think in this song we had to totally change the kind. It doesn't sound like, you know, Tangent as such. It's darker. It's sort of it's got more of a kind of city at night atmosphere. It sort of drones a little bit, and it's got atmospherics, and so. You know, in the other songs where I'm usually channeling people like Wakeman, Emerson, Dave Stewart, you know, my other keyboards heroes. In this one, I think you'll hear more kind of Edgar Fries, more Richard Barbieri, more kind of Trent Reznor. You know, textures and sort of atmospherics. Yeah, that's the lady tied to the lamppost.